so many players that I've played with have got the most bizarre superstitions.
As you can tell, I am not happy by the amount of voice notes I've sent you. Croucher needs to be educated.
Hello and welcome to another episode of That Peter Crouch Podcast with me, Peter Crouch, Chris Stark and Statman Dave with me as usual. You all right, boys? So good?
I'm all right. I've got a question for you two chaps. Have you ever been in out on a night out and then the clocks have gone back? Really weird moment.
I feel like this was quite a secretive clock going back one.
In what sense?
Well, I don't think it was enough press.
I agree.
I feel that one crept up on me.
Yeah.
Well, I feel the same about Crouchfest, ironically, but we'll get into that. We'll get into that very shortly. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Do you know what I mean? Like, usually you know, like, people go, oh, does it go forward or back tonight?
But this
like,
is the best one.
I was like, bang. So obviously my watch was 8 and Ab was going, it's 7.
Yeah.
I said, it's, oh my God, it's gone back.
I was out at 2 a.m. when it went back to 1 a.m. So I was in a car.
Where were you?
Yeah.
I was in a car on the way back from a place I was DJing. And so I'm looking at the clock. It says 1 a.m. Sorry, it says 2 a.m. And the newsreader's going, it's 1 a.m. I'm thinking, fuck, this is a moment. But I tell you where it gets interesting, that is, you know, if you're in a club and it hits 2 a.m. and the club closes at 2, can you legitimately then go to the bouncer and say, hang on, have a look at your watch, 1 a.m.?
But do they not? Do they not?
No, they 100% did. That's why I was sort of lost.
Yeah, you have another hour in the club.
Because it was another hour in the club and then it was like 1:30 and I'm like, why am I so tired? It was actually 2:30.
Mm. Yeah.
Just blew my mind.
Where were you, out of interest?
Manchester. Blues Kitchen. I had a great time. Oh, that was a great time.
Are we the only like nation that do this? The clocks?
No. Piss around with the clock?
Well, it's just so... it's such a it's so mysterious, isn't it? Like, why do we do it? No one else does it, do they?
I also wonder, is 2 a.m. the best time to gain an hour? Do you know what I mean? Like, if they're going to change it at any point, like, what happens with the 3 o'clock kickoffs, for example, if the clocks go back an hour at 3? Imagine the carnage for a football fan that's 3 or 4 pints in.
You're making...
trying to work out when they should be at the stadium.
My head hurt already.
So, Crouchfest, lads, we're pretty close. How's the organisation, the prep going?
Mm. Yeah, well, we're beavering away, aren't we, Chris? So, like, loads going on. We have booked a few big acts. I don't know if we should tell people a couple.
No, I would like us to keep as much of it a surprise as possible because I think the first Crouchfest was good. People are legitimately asking questions, though, going, like, boys, it's Wembley Arena. We're buying tickets without knowing anything. And we should say thank you for that trust as well. It's not something we take lightly.
Well, last time we managed to prove that we could pull it together. It was epic.
But I think the thing is with this, I do understand, and there have been discussions about this. There are, you know, it's a huge event and it would be nice for people to have a flavour of what they can look forward to.
Mm.
We should say there is so much stuff up in the air. It's proper. I don't think there's anything wrong in saying it's, what's the phrase, Dave? Is it arse against the sea or are flying something? Anyway, the point is there will be stuff sorted last minute.
What was that saying?
Arse against the water?
Arse against the fire?
Sea of the pants or something like that. Is it one of those?
Yeah, sea of the pants?
Flying by the seat of
our
pants.
That's why I couldn't be a pundit.
They're flying by the sea.
What's the phrase, Crouchy?
I think it's flying by the seat of your pants, I think.
Fuck knows what that means.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know, but thanks for bringing it up.
There will be some of that. Some of the stuff we are arranging is going to be last minute.
Going to the wire.
But it will be all the better for it. I became aware that I think Wembley Arena would like to know all the plans 3 weeks in advance. But that, I just want to say right now, is not going to be possible. It will be a better show if we don't.
Yeah. Wembley, if you're listening, you will not get the plans 3 weeks before, unfortunately.
I remember being told, like, we need to have everything locked off 3 weeks before. Now, 3 months ago, I was like, not a problem at all. I'm going to say this now. It will not be 3 weeks before the event. I think it is already 3 weeks before the event. So.
Well, it potentially won't be three days before, will it?
Right, lads, one of the things that we're doing the Messi and Ronaldo referendum. We're working out who's the better player. We're going to be doing that at Crouchfest. Have you got any more texts or anything back, Crouchy, from people that you've been speaking to?
Yeah, well, like, so far, I was just sort of going down the phone book, really. Obviously, Sean Dyche got back to us, Anthony Joshua, Michael McIntyre got back to us, didn't he? So I've actually got a few more. Flintoff got back to me.
Did he?
Ronaldo or Messi? What do you think?
I'm going to go Flintoff. I'm going to say Ronaldo.
I reckon Ronaldo as well.
I do, Crouchy. What a question that is. Messi or Ronaldo? It's like picking one of your favourite kids. Problem is, in my house, I got one of my lads who just loves Ronaldo, other one loves Messi, so I can't bring myself. And they keep blinding me with stats and telling me why one's better. I can sit on the fence here. At times, Messi's been better, especially now. And Ronaldo, I'm going Ronaldo. Lives near me. He's got cars, but Messi has as well. But Ronaldo, having said that, none of them are Haaland. Even before City, early now, when he's like a young Peter Crouch. Before Crouch, he got his pace and power. I hope that helps. It was nice to see you the other day. Oh, I needed that. Pulled over. I was desperate. It was one of them where you go. Oh, anyway, I'm off for now. I'm on my oldies. See you later.
Fair play to him. Ronaldo, man. Supervet got in touch. And now you are not across Supervet's work, are you?
No.
Or you, Dave?
No.
I don't know where you've been. Like, seriously, how can you not know who Supervet is?
It's so weird you get such a hard-on for the Supervet, because...
He's been in my house. I've been out for dinner with him. Where he is, anyway, is his take on the Messi and Ronaldo debate.
Hi, Peter. Noel Fitzpatrick, Supervet here. Ronaldo versus Messi. Well, it's not going to come down to who scored more goals, more hat-tricks, more titles scored in every minute of the 19. No, sir.
That's your stuff.
It's about attitude to adversity, in my opinion. He might appear sullen on the outside, but his discipline... his state of persistent readiness, his hunger, is in my opinion unparalleled in world football. And of course, as a fan of Man United, I am, however, biased. But for me, Ronaldo every time, my friend Ronaldo every time.
Strong answer from Supervet. Packs in a few stats there as well. And
yeah, he does, and belittles them. It's upsetting. It's an upsetting day for me. Lionel Messi, though, this season is kind of breaking the records again.
At the time of this recording, I'm hearing he might be going to Inter Miami.
He may be, yeah. But then Barcelona also knocking around.
Do you not? Oh, right. Okay.
Then what?
So back to Barcelona could be an option.
Barcelona, yeah. But mind you, they're financially, they can't. Surely can't.
And Messi surely doesn't want to play in the Europa League next season, which is current.
Anyway, Joe Cole's been in touch.
Hello, mate. Yeah, do you know what? Messi versus Ronaldo, it's always a tough one because we were just so blessed to play in our era. But I'm going to go with a little fella because I just think he just looks... He does things that other players can only dream of. And I can sort of see what Ronaldo does, although I could never do it myself, and it's incredible and he's amazing. With Messi, it's like I find it impossible to comprehend some of the passes, some of the vision, the goals, everything. So, but we are lucky to have them both.
That's from a maverick himself, Joe Cole.
Short back and short, though, isn't it? No one under 5'8" is going Ronaldo.
Yeah, but I'm 6'7" and I went Messi. If you look
yeah,
at the other
but
way.
I just mean the other way around. If you're under 5 foot, if you're like...
Well, he's holding out for the small kids.
I just reckon statistically, more people under 5'5" are going to vote Messi.
Do you think?
I just think
that's
they
a
are.
Stat for you, Dave. Let's find out.
I think we need to get the listeners to get in touch. Anyone that's under 5'5", you say, Chris?
Anyone under 5'5"?
I'm a short ass. Maybe we say 5'7" and below.
5'7" and a half.
Okay.
Messi's, I think his height's around that.
If you're shorter than 5'7½", but would vote Ronaldo, let us know, because I don't think there'll be one.
I reckon you're right. There'll be more under that height voting Messi.
We've also had podcasts recently with Jermaine Defoe and Ed Sheeran.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting with Jermaine as well, getting into his head about his journey and stuff. Because everyone's got a different journey. I mean, don't just take my word for it. Like, that was my path, but everyone's got different paths. So it was interesting hearing Jermaine's one.
Yeah, so we thought we'd do a podcast today all about superstitions, which I know with you were massive. It was routine.
Yeah, yeah, they were. And by the end, I had so many, I had to stop and be superstitious about not having a superstition, bizarrely. And that seemed to work for me.
You went the, you went full circle.
Full circle, yeah. I was like, don't have any superstitions. And that be my superstition, if you know what I mean, because things were getting silly.
So you basically like 360'd the game and now you're just in this super position.
Mm.
Impressive.
But superstitions are massive amongst players, right?
Yeah, I mean...
I bet you've seen some weird ones as well.
Yeah, you see, you know, the start of games, people doing the most bizarre things and it becomes just totally acceptable. You're just like, that's his thing. You know, when you sign a new player, you go, that's what he does and you leave them to it.
Well, we've had loads of questions on this topic as well. So thank you so much if we do get around to doing one of your questions. And remember as well, if you do want to get involved in the podcast and you want to send a question, you can do it by going to thatpetercrouchpodcast.com. And there's a section there where you can submit any questions you like. You can also get tickets for Crouch Fest whilst you're there as well.
Crouch, you mentioned you're a bit of a superstitious person. What are the classic superstitions that you kind of believe in?
Well, things like walking under a ladder, you know, why would you take the risk? It's the mirror, that's 7 years. What? Why on earth would you break a mirror?
Is it not a bit like when you see a sign saying, wet paint, do not touch? You sort of, there's something about it that makes you want to touch. Like, I sort of want to smash up a mirror just to deal with it in my head.
Yeah, but imagine in the sixth year of your bad luck, you go, I wish I'd never smashed that fucking mirror.
It's a massive... it's a massive bet, isn't it?
Well, you feel like, what's the point of taking that risk? It's probably bullshit, but what if it's not?
I think if you smash a mirror, you're probably not in a good place anyway.
Right? Other questions you got to answer before that.
But do you know what? I do like, in general life, obviously there's loads of stuff that goes on with football, but taking myself out of football, the three drains thing, I do stand on two and walk around the other one. And two drains, I will do them as good luck. I'll stand on the two drains.
What's the drain one?
You know when you see three drains in a row, you didn't do this. No. So at school, someone told me that if you stand on all three drains, it's bad luck. But like, I'll walk and I'll see three drains and I'll stand on two and walk around the last one.
Do you?
Yeah.
It's a bit like those videos you see of the players walking around the badges in the grounds. You see, they won't stand on the Man City.
Yeah, but someone put something in your head like, one for sorrow, two for joy with the magpies. Like, I still to this day salute one magpie.
So is there anything in threes you struggle with?
Well, three's okay because it's one for sorrow, two for joy, three for a girl, four for a boy, five six for gold and seven for a secret never to be told.
So what gets you a girl if you see three magpies?
Three magpies,
Do you have to do anything to them or
just see them? No, the way I looked at it was like, you'll have a girl first. And then four, you'd have a boy.
Oh, you mean
five
babies?
Five, silver, six is gold, and seven's for a secret never to be told. If you see seven, it's a secret. But you can break that spell usually by, if I did that, you would put your finger in it and pull. That would break the spell.
Oh, right. I thought that was something else. I thought if you do that, and you see it, dude, it's like an okay sign. I get to punch you and
something like that. Yeah. But that was something. And then I realized it because you have to be with someone for that. So then I had to train myself to go, it's okay to salute the magpies.
How many magpies for a career in the Premier League?
The reason I got in the Premier League was that because I did salute those sorrows.
So you do salute the magpies?
Yeah, still now,
do you actually?
Yeah,
that's amazing.
But I try and do it slyly. I try and like brush my...
If a load of magpies were released in front of you on BT Sport...
Blow my mind.
You'd be there saluting them.
No, because obviously there's certain numbers for... If there's loads of them, you're usually all right. But there's usually one or two.
I'm going to try and get hold of a fucking magpie. Like... Imagine someone brings one to a game just for you. I just love to see you saluting it.
But yeah, but it's little things like that that, like, throughout my football career as well, like, if I didn't do them, it would be in the back of your mind, like, oh, is that why? I don't know. It's lots of footballers and lots of sportsmen are the same.
Mm. So let's take it to the dressing room then, Crouchy. 2 o'clock on a Saturday, you got a game at 3 o'clock. Mm. What is going on in the dressing room?
Well, it's complete carnage. Like, if you think so many players that I've played with have got the most bizarre superstitions. When I was a young player, I had loads, like tie-ups. had to be on like left one first, right one first. Shin pads had to be on a specific way. I wouldn't change my boots if I'd scored. Specific meals before and after if I'd score. I'd have to sleep like the one particular way. I'd have to have my pillow the right way. I would pray. so many.
I didn't know you were religious, Crouch.
Well, for goals, I am. I suppose towards the sort of end, I had to rein in my superstitions, but I still kept to this day. I'd come out. I'd always look for my dad, and my dad would freak me out if I couldn't see my dad at a game, because he would always get there early, and I'd be able to wave to him, and that comforted me. And then when we did the lineup, I'd be there at the lineup. We'd shake hands, and at the end of every handshake, I would jump, head an imaginary ball. I would run as fast as I can. I would clap the fans on that far side. Then I would bend down and I would tie my right lace.
Every time?
Without fail, every match that I ever played in.
I didn't know. Did you know that? Have you put stats on this?
I didn't know that, no. But we'll have to go back and review the footage. Mm. See the completion rate of the header, the sprint.
Saying, were your laces undone?
So this boils down to early on. I remember when I was a kid, my boot coming off once and me thinking, oh my God, I can't have this happen to me again. So I'd always go, right, I'll tie it up so it's on properly, the right one. And so ever since then, that was just in my head. It might come off. Right? And that, it just sort of triggered. And then I ended up going, right, well, I'd play well in that. So and then I always did it. I never ever stopped it.
So from a psychological perspective, the routine, it gives you an illusion of control. So every time that Crouch is tying his boot, he's in control, which obviously helps you out in terms of reducing stress and eases the feeling of helplessness from a psychological perspective. Mm. So these routines that the players are doing are actually quite beneficial.
It's definitely psychological. I know it doesn't mean anything, but it's things I think you go to. No one would ever get on a team bus and go and sit in a different location. No one would ever come in and sit in a different place in the dressing room. You'd have the massage at the same time. You'd do everything would be in a routine. And if you come out of that routine, it just makes you a bit unsettled when you're in that anxious state of mind.
So if we were to see every game that you'd done, it would be that same routine. It would be the...
Yeah.
Imaginary header, run around.
Imaginary header, run, clap, lace.
So you see, I reckon other players would have seen you doing that when you were on good form and gone, shit, this is Crouchy's routine that he does. Did you ever catch anyone copying the same? Did suddenly someone start doing the same?
No, but you see it now. I know plenty of players who aren't religious crossing themselves, because they've seen it on players that they admire.
Interesting.
You see it, even with the kids, they're all doing, doing the hop on and looking up at the sky and crossing themselves, grabbing the grass, even putting it in their mouth, kissing it, kissing the ring. That these things, lots of players that they admire, they would copy, I think.
That's interesting. Doing the cross without being religious. I've kissing seen it on a ring and you're not married.
Wow.
Kids doing it on a Saturday afternoon now. Kids are kissing rings on a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
Because they've seen, Suarez kisses tattoos. No tattoos on them.
Yeah.
Kissing tattoos.
Was there any that you saw that were kind of quirky to the point of you sort of really noticed it with a player? And
well, John Terry with England training would have, he wouldn't be able to touch the ball in the dressing room with his feet. So, lads would throw him a ball and he'd just lift his feet up like that and let it go past.
So what's going on there?
Yeah, he had a lot of superstitions. Yeah. he changed his boots constantly as well. He'd have a new pair for the start of the game, a new pair at half time, and then a new pair for the next game. So
that's an odd superstition, isn't it? Because it would normally be... Surely that you have the same ones and the fear that...
Mm.
Yeah.
And also, I would always change my shirt at halftime. That became a thing. I always had long sleeve.
Yeah.
Even when I rolled them up. And if it was hot, I would never wear short sleeve ever. There was so... I used to have so many. The tie-ups thing used to tape for a little bit. But things change as well. like lots of players now, they have new pairs of boots all the time. Like I couldn't do that. Like if I'd scored, I was, and the sponsors would be like, no, you have to get in this pair. And I'm like, I've just scored 3 and 3. Yeah. Like,
would you rather have that discussion? Would you?
Oh, I'd rather not be sponsored.
Yeah, but you don't have that choice at that point, do you?
Yeah, but you do because I'd be like, well, how are you going to stop me?
God, that's massive, isn't it? Adidas or...
Yeah, well, my agent had loads of issues with sponsors because I'd be in the boots from like 2 years previous because I was doing well.
So your agent would have to say to these guys, it's like, look, he's not wearing the boots.
I'm not wearing them, no. Yeah, I had loads of discussions like that. But like some people couldn't understand why you would be like that. But I was.
But at the same time, surely that's a reason for them to allow you to do what you want. Because if you're saying, oh, I've had these boots for 2 years, they're this brand, they've been that good for 2 years, and I'm scoring goals in them, what's the problem? Well, I understand a new model.
They don't sell them anymore, that's the problem.
That's the whole reason he's wearing the boots in the first place, is they want to sell a few.
I can get hold of them.
Speaking of John Terry, did you know about this? So Chelsea received complaints from the FA after they consistently left their dressing room late before kickoffs.
No, I didn't know about this.
I've got a bit on this. So it was all because John Terry would only use his favourite urinal in the dressing room. Frank Lampard and Ashley Cole both adopted it as their lucky urinal. And as the run of victories continued, that resulted in the whole squad queuing to use the same single urinal, despite there being 3 to choose from. So kickoffs, like the players weren't coming out because there was a queue to use one urinal.
Doesn't surprise me in the slightest.
But it's almost like contagious superstition being contagious. It's worked for one. He's recommended it to Lamps.
Yeah, but
the whole squad are obviously following their leaders. Like, it's actually insane. And it feels a bit like, you know where you try to get your kid to do a wee before you go on holiday? It's like, even the junior members of that squad must be like, John, I just don't need to go. I don't need one. Just try.
Squeeze it out.
It's a long game.
Terry's behind, holding up. Just try. Weird fucking thing to say as a parent, Dave. It's one of those things you have to do.
Oh, yeah.
Trying to get your kids to piss before a long journey.
Right, lads. Let's get into Kolo Touré. He always had to be the last player to enter the pitch. And in one game, Arsenal started the second half with 9 men after William Gallas was delayed at halftime after receiving treatment. And Touré refused to come on before his teammate.
Yeah, I get it. I get that. And like I say, you know, an African player there, like some of them were really, you know, took it seriously, very seriously. And I'm sure Kolo Touré is the same.
Was this not just an Eggy Boff scenario?
Potentially. You can see Gallas calling an Eggy Boff.
Just was always hit every time. Fucking hell, you done me again.
Crouch, here's his teammate. What, you know, you're starting the second half with 9 men. What are you saying to him? Come on, Kolo, get on the pitch.
You can't be... I mean, that is... It's ridiculous, taking it too far, isn't it? Like, there are ones that go too far, without doubt.
We talk about players. What about managers? Did you see any managers with superstitions?
Yeah, like... Harry used to be quite open with his superstitions. I remember at Southampton, he wore this like dog tie. It actually looked like his dog. I think, what are they? Like little English bulldogs.
Mm.
Of maybe French ones. I don't know. A bulldog of some sort. And he added like a tie with them on. And we won and he wore it for the next sort of 3 games. So I remember noticing it because it was a bit of a rascal tie, to be honest. And then the fact that he wore it 3 games on the trot, I was like, that's a superstition. Yeah, I always find that the night games, like, because it's the day of a game, like, I'd rather get the game out early because the whole morning, the whole afternoon and the whole evening is taken up with, like, superstitions. Like the Champions League nights, for instance, would just annoy me so much. I'd wake up, I'd have to do a specific breakfast. Then it'd be like a specific lunch. You know, you'd have to do something. And then you'd go, right, you've got 2 hours to go to sleep. And that sleep period before a night game is so strange. I think I think we go to sleep sort of between 3 and 5.
I don't know how you do that.
It's so weird. Like going in, and often we'd be rooming with someone and he might have a different routine. Like Wayne Rooney, for instance, wouldn't be able to sleep ever. Like he was just constantly on the go. And imagine rooming with him, but you're in the where you need to sleep. It became sort of like just a complete head fuck.
Do you know about this sleep situation, Dave? So they would have it blew my mind when he first said this. They'd have a sleep before the game. But like, you know where you try and get to sleep, but you're not tired, but you know you need to do it because the manager's told you to do it. That's quite a niche situation. But you know, even like when it's late at night and you're like, fuck, I've got to be up early in the morning, try and get to sleep. You just can't do
There's nothing but worse than going
up.
3 in the afternoon.
I can empathise with it. Because
dark room. Like, I like the fact that it was completely silent and you'd think, right, I'm about to go into a cauldron of like 60,000 people.
It's so weird.
And like, you're just in a bed on your own and like, you're thinking, I could stay here.
It's so weird.
I'm not coming out.
You could stay there and like have no pressure, no nervous energy, no anxiety. All those things going around your head.
But it's similar in a sense to like you know, you work in the morning, you know, you've got a big night out in the evening. Sometimes you need to get that nap in before you go out. And look, you don't want to do that, Chris, but you need to stay up until 3 in the morning.
But like, I find it just so funny, the idea of all these footballers being put to bed at 3 in the afternoon. Like,
taken again, to the toilet and then like, put to bed.
But it does feel a bit, so true. It does feel a bit like that because nothing about these guys must have wanted to sleep. But, you know, the manager has said it's got to happen.
It's so true.
So bizarre.
Like, and also, you know, some of the young lads usually don't get up for breakfast. So they lie in till about 11 and then they can't really sleep in the afternoon. What I found was my optimal level towards the end was like, I'd get up reasonably early because I had kids that by then, and then I'd have breakfast and then I'd get up and I'd hang around and I might have a cup of tea with the lads and we'd chat for a bit and then I'd just go to bed about 1. But I'd hang around and I might do something and then I'd have lunch and then I'd go back to my room and that's when I'd sleep. I'd have like an hour and a half. That was when I was, and there's nothing better than when you've done things correctly and then you step onto the pitch at say 7:30, the game for 7:45, and you go like, and you feel wired. Like there's nothing better than that. Like, oh, but I've done it the other way around where I've gone, oh, I feel a bit tired. Like not tired, but you're just not at that optimal level of firing. And there's nothing worse than that. And then you think, oh my God, and then it's in your head. And you think, because it's the slightest thing that gets in your head that puts you off and, you know, makes you have a maybe not as good a game because it's just, that's what superstition is. It's like, well, or routine.
I think that's the thing with all of this. There's a big overlap between routine and superstition. I didn't think I really had any, but I have to have a notepad in front of me. They all take the piss out of me in my new place at Capital. Because they've started calling me Stan because I have to have a notepad and I just write little notes and little doodles as I'm talking.
Really?
I don't know why that is. And they're all on laptops. They're all on, they've all got it. And I've turned up with my shitty little notepad.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're doing doodles.
Well, I like that. Like,
it's
that's
a bit old school, isn't it?
It's good, isn't it? It's like, you know, iPads and laptops. Get a pad out.
That's what I mean. Just write little thoughts, little...
It's good. Bang. Things.
Yeah. Good. Stan, though.
Why I mean, Stan? Is,
well, because that Eminem song, you know, where you can hear the, you know...
Oh.
Dear Slim. I wrote you, buddy.
We've got a few more superstitions that we've had a look at, Crouchy. Which ones have caught your eye?
Well, Barry Fry's tickled me here. Apparently, Barry Fry pissed on each corner of the pitch at St Andrews when he was manager of Birmingham. They went on to win 7 of their next 10 games, drawing twice and losing just once. Unfortunately, he still got relegated.
What was this? Whilst there was a crowd in there? Go to each corner.
You must have done that what, before the game or...
Well, surely once a season, not before every match. Surely there wasn't a moment. Please someone confirm or deny this. So Barry Fry would sort of bless every corner of that pitch. Like, what was the routine there? Like,
Bruce Grobler
been every game.
That. Bruce Grobler did that as well. Did you know that?
Pissed in the corner of the pitch.
Bruce Grobler pissed in his goal mouth. Okay, let me just read this to you. I think it's better if I read it to you. Back in 92, during Grobler's testimonial game, the goalkeeper had taken a sponsorship with the Zambezi Lager. The company sent out a witch doctor to Anfield to present a bottle of lager to Grobler. However, they may have left more than just the beverage. It was said that the man had placed a curse on the club. He went around on the post and put his goat's tail, put his water on the posts of both sides, got the microphone and said, "If you don't have the jungle man Bruce Grobler in here, you won't win the title." For years, Grobler sat at home and watched the club fail to win a league title for 28 years. He thought it was his fault and he brought the witch doctor in, yet he was hopeless to do anything about the curse. Grobler decided the only way to lift the curse would be to urinate on both sets of goalposts. He attempted this first in 2013-14 season, but Grobler would only get as far as the cop end, being thrown out before the stopper could make it to the Anfield Road end. So he he urinated on one end and couldn't get to the other because he'd get thrown out. And he believes, he told me this, I was working on BT Sport with him and he was a guest, and he said to me that he genuinely believes that this curse was on Liverpool.
Okay,
and the reason they didn't win the league was because a witch doctor had done it to him, and the fact that he wasn't in goal.
Fine, but I understand him not being in goal then being the issue because of the curse, but why did Grobler think him pissing on the post would remove the curse? And also, just on a logistical level here, pissing on one set of posts, as a man, it's a struggle to stop. He's had to hold his piss and run to the other end.
Yeah. Well,
that's,
I don't know the logistics
feat,
that, of
it, isn't it?
But he's not finished. He said, "I fulfilled my task. Last season, I played in a corporate game at Anfield. We were in the dressing room and the guy said, 'You have to do the business today.' I said, 'Okay.' So I took a water bottle, poured the water out, peed in the bottle and came back. First half at the cop end, I splashed it all over the post. Second time, I came down the Anfield Road end and I splashed it all over the other posts. The campaign following, Liverpool went on to win the title."
Can't argue.
"The first title the club has had since Grobler left the club.
So
there are still debates whether the curse was real, but either way, Liverpool won the title after Grobler had laid his urine at both ends."
And before then, it'd been cursed. They hadn't got anything.
Nothing to do with Jurgen Klopp, nothing to do with the players. I think that's the reason.
So Grobler's piss produces success.
I think so.
So let's get him to Crouch Fest. 100%.
What, Grobler both ends?
Pisses all over the stage. Liverpool aren't exactly flying at the moment. Should we be suggesting if I was Klopp, I wouldn't rule it out. Are you trying to be antagonistic on this?
No.
So you think keepers are playing a different sport?
Well, it's not. They've got all different rules than anyone else.
This is why. This
he's
is
got a different kit on. The reason he's got a different kit on.
So I keep getting these sort of ranty voicemails from Ramsdale, who clearly listens to his podcast on the way to train. Doesn't seem to affect his form particularly. They're flying. But he'll then message me angry about something you've said about goalkeepers. And maybe I've now become a bit more aware of it.
Yeah, well, I've fired him up to get to be number one.
I got one a
England's
couple of days
number
ago.
One.
He's not happy. Have a listen to the latest one.
"Starkey, it's me again. And again, I'm listening to the pod on the way to footy. Listen, goalie coaches are better at finishing, or goalkeepers are better at finishing as a finishing drill than players will be. Not in terms of actual overall finishing, but they do it every day. This thing, what Crouch is saying about strikers would be best for the goalkeepers, but they wouldn't. They miss the target 80% of the time. Yes, they can put it in the top corners, but it's about working the goalkeeper. I'm not happy with this segment. I'm going to be honest. Crouchy, he's letting me down. I'm going to be honest. And the reason no players, or hardly any players, will go into goalkeeper coaching, saying a fucking clue about goalkeeping, whereas goalkeepers have to know about goalkeeping and what every other 10 outfield players are doing. As you can tell, I'm not happy by the amount of voice notes I've sent you, but Crouchy needs to be educated."
Great episode today, chaps. We spoke goalkeepers, superstitions.
Yeah, it's been good. I enjoyed it. Nice to go back over the old superstitions. What I realised when coming here today, that actually I've still got loads, like the magpies and the drains, various bits and pieces that I still take into everyday life.
Yeah. Let us know if any of this resonated with you on social. Just get in touch with us, or you can get on the website, thatpetercrouchpodcast.com. Make sure you submit questions or any stories, anything we've been chatting about that you want to feed in on, you can do on there.
And also, if you've got superstitions, get in touch. Chumbawamba.
Chumbawamba, everyone.
Chumbawamba.